excellent too. He has had a fascinating career, not only a journalistic career, but he has been a foreign correspondent for The Economist for quite a while and for other publications. His assignments have taken him to Southeast Asia, Washington, D.C., Paris, Los Angeles, the Middle East, and I imagine you've seen other parts of the world that you might be able to tell us about at various points. He has covered some of the most momentous events that have taken place in recent history, including Tiananmen Square, political crises in the Philippines, and the occasionally unsavory time of the Clinton administration during the 1990s, I understand, particularly the second term.
The second term.
The particularly exciting second term, as we refer to it.
Gus's starring part.
Right. His reports are always lively, engaging, and his books have always been well received. His latest book, which he's going to be talking about tonight, and which he's brought copies of, is called The World of Conflict, Understanding the World's Trouble Spots. It is, I can attest, a highly readable compendium of where we are regarding wars, terrorism, and all manner of conflict in the world today. It goes through region by region, occasionally country by country, telling us everything that's going on. It is the kind of book to keep close at hand if by any chance you are liable to fall into some mythical state and thinking that we're about to turn the corner and the world is about to break out in global peace. It's the kind of book that will remind you conflict is always with us, so I do commend it to you. John is going to be speaking tonight about the foreign policy challenges for Europe and America, and he asks if those challenges are shared or at odds. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming John Andrews. Thank you very much for joining us this evening. I wish I could have filled this room for you, but we fill it with spirit.
Indeed. Russ, thank you very much. Russ, I gather from your accent that you may come from the other side of the planet.
I am from one of the places where you've been stationed, Washington, D.C.
Aha. And are you going to cast a vote?
I am going to cast a vote. In the state of Virginia.
And are you guys going to cast a vote on June 23rd? Okay, I say that because I don't want to tell you actually all that's in the book, because I'm rather hoping that you will actually buy it and read it and enjoy it. But it looks at today's wars, an awful lot of them, from Colombia, where happily the government and the FARC guerrillas are pretty close to a peace deal after half a century of war. And it goes to the Philippines, where the government has to cope not just with Islamist extremists, but also with a stubbornly entrenched communist insurgency. And of course, you're all aware of the conflicts in the Middle East and Africa and the sectarian hostility between Sunni and Shia Islam. In short, I've had plenty of stuff to write about, and there's plenty of stuff in the book, which I hope you will read. Now, I want to concentrate, however, on the challenges that these conflicts, especially those in the Middle East and North Africa, impose on us here in Europe and on our traditional ally, the United States. Now, I do this because we've got a rather daunting timetable. The US is going to choose a new president, thanks to Russell, on November the 8th. And next year, there will be a presidential election in France and a federal election in Germany. So, quite possibly, François Hollande will not get a second term in France. As you know, he is very unpopular. You've got Emmanuel Macron, who's making waves about possibly running against him, and so on. Quite possibly also in Germany, you'll have a new Bundestag, which will decide to dump Angela Merkel as Germany's chancellor. That would be pretty rare. German chancellors tend to be re-elected and re-elected and live and rule forever. But it could happen because of the migration crisis and the general shift to the right in Europe. And as for the United States, well, I think the odds favor Hillary Clinton as the first woman president, but she does have this likability factor or unlikability factor. And you can't exclude the possibility that a demagogic real estate tycoon with a pretty strange hairdo will somehow make his way to the Oval Office. Now, there's one other date that I hope you will bear in mind, and quite possibly, in defiance of common sense, in my humble opinion, Britain will vote on June the 23rd to leave the European Union. Now, whatever happens in all these votes, one thing I think is clear. No leader will actually be able to ignore the conflicts that scar so much of the Muslim world. It stretches from Morocco, on the coast of the Atlantic, to Indonesia, and to the southern parts of the Philippines. Doubtless, the next American president, the usual burden that comes with being in the White House, there'll be partisan gridlock in Washington, questions about the economy, about healthcare, illegal immigration, the relationship with China, the NATO alliance, the European Union, the difficult relationship with Russia, the Russia of Vladimir Putin, question of the European Union, the perennial question of North Korea. Clearly, whoever becomes president is going to have plenty on, choose the pronoun, her or his plate. But I think what will really cause a presidential headache will be the situation in and around the Middle East. I'm going to stretch the geography of the Middle East a little bit. Afghanistan, where the Taliban are back with a vengeance. Pakistan, which is almost a failed state, but one which now has nuclear weapons. Iraq, where the Islamic State still controls Mosul. Syria, now mired in civil war for the fifth year in succession. And of course, you've got the aftermath of the Arab Spring, which has turned Libya into a failed state on a par with Somalia or Yemen. And it's resulted in Egypt once again becoming basically a dictatorship. And meanwhile, of course, the Israel-Palestine dispute continues to fester, making America ever less popular in the Muslim world. All of that, if you were the guy or the lady in the White House, you would think is a pretty poor return for all the blood and treasure that the US has expended over the years. But, I mean, we're in Europe, and we don't, you know, when you mention Israel, for example, Israel is incredibly important in American politics. It's much less important in European politics. We don't have the same problem. It is a problem how to deal with the Arab-Israeli dispute. To us, it's kind of away. But in American politics, it is incredibly important. Remember that the most powerful lobbying group in the States, probably APAC, which is the American-Israel Public Affairs Council Committee. And every candidate for the presidency attended the annual meeting this year. It's very, very important that we in Europe tend not to realize this. But it will be very important for the US president. But back to Europe, can we actually snigger at all these problems in America? I mean, we tend to, because we all think we are actually, sorry Russell, superior to America, basically. You talk to these students. Well, actually, of course, we can't really snigger at America's problems, because America's headaches are ours as well. We are fellow members of NATO, number one. And secondly, and more important in perhaps in terms of public opinion, conflict in the Middle East and North Africa is the spur that is driving migrants by the many thousands, hundreds of thousands, indeed, last year, just over a million, to seek refuge in the European Union. I'm saying migrants, I'm not making any technical distinction here between refugees and economic migrants. I mean, everybody is just hoping for some kind of security and a better life. So what is the biggest issue for those who seek a Brexit? It's immigration, the desire to control our borders, whatever that really means. And that same impulse is actually being felt right across the European Union. The UKIP drive in Britain was to raise the drawbridge against migrants from the rest of the EU. The drive across the rest of the EU is much the same. It's to build a wall against the Muslim invasion, putting the word in inverted commas. A complicated endeavor, given, of course, that there are millions of Muslims who are European Union citizens. I point that out because, you know, the Middle East is going to be a big headache for America. It is also, of course, a big headache for Europe because of the question of immigration. So, what should we do? Chapter 6 in my book has the title, The United States, Both Superpower and Vulnerable Goliath. Chapter 4 is on Europe. The UK and Europe, Bloody Past, Complacent Present, Uncertain Future. Let me take the US first. Madeleine Albright, you may remember, was Bill Clinton's Secretary of State. She said back in 1998, America is the indispensable nation. It's a phrase that has been picked up by basically all political scientists. Hubert Védrine, who was the France's foreign minister at the time in the government of Lionel Jospin, followed up by describing America as a hyperpuissance, the implication being that America is a hyperpower, a bit more than being a mere superpower. Well, maybe so, but those were the days before 9/11, before the invasion of Afghanistan, before the Iraq War, before, of course, the rise of ISIS and the establishment of the so-called Islamic State. And I might add, before Vladimir Putin diminished the notion of American hyperpuissance by annexing Crimea and by interfering in Syria in support of Bashar al-Assad. So no wonder the Donald has this slogan, this promise, make America great again. And no wonder that appeals to so many. I know that Russell obviously would vote for the Donald. But it is, of course, that's British humor. It's an empty slogan. America doesn't have to be great again. It is already great. It accounts for 40%, maybe a bit more, of the world's spending on defense, from bunker-busting missiles to the world's most advanced jet fighters. It's got a military presence of one kind or another in literally scores of foreign nations. Back in 2011, a congressman called Ron Paul, a bit of a right-wing libertarian, made a doomed attempt to get the nomination for the presidency. And he said during his campaign, we're under great threat because we occupy so many countries. We the Americans, we're in 130 countries. Well, in 130 countries, when you think that the UN has 197 countries, that's quite a big claim. But you know, when the Washington Post fact-checked Ron Paul's claim, it found actually this figure was on the low side. The Post managed to find 153 countries which are hosting military personnel. Now, I've no idea what the number is today, but in 2014, US Special Forces, you know, the SEALs, the Green Berets, Delta Force, so on, they were deployed in 133 different countries. And you know they're now in Libya, they're in Syria, they're in Iraq, you know, under the radar, but they're there. So the bottom line is that in conventional military terms, America reigns supreme, and it's going to continue to do so for decades to come. So why is there some angst in America? Why does Donald Trump appeal to so many? Why did General Martin Dempsey, who was then the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, say to a House committee back in 2012, in my personal military judgment, formed over 38 years, we are living in the most dangerous time in my lifetime, right now? Well, one answer, of course, is that generals like to have all their military toys. In his farewell speech as President Dwight Eisenhower, this is way before you guys were born, the start of the war, he said, he warned Americans against what he called the military-industrial complex. I mean, he coined that phrase. And what's true of America is true of Britain too, and of France. In both France and Britain, the generals have lobbied very hard to stem the cuts visited on their personnel and equipment by the bean counters, George Osborne, etc., in the Treasury and in the French finance ministry. But I think there's a different answer to explain the atmosphere of Western worry, of Western angst. It's the difficulty, I think it's actually the impossibility, which I think you'll find in the book, that all governments have in dealing with asymmetric warfare, a concept that's been around ever since David used a catapult to kill Goliath. Well, it didn't take high technology, for example, for Al-Qaeda to commit the outrage of 9/11. It just needed fewer men who could point a plane at the targets. No need to actually master the art of landing a plane. And so too with the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq. An IED, improvised explosive device, it's not exactly high tech. It's just a bit of explosive material, put it on the ground, and you detonate it with a cell phone, sometimes, often, with pretty catastrophic effects. And the fact is that the United States, the greatest military power in the world, has been humbled by this use of asymmetric warfare. And actually, so have we in Europe. The EU's common security and defense policy may look pretty good as an idea to the guy, people who wrote the signed the Lisbon Treaty, but the reality is that only Britain and France have both the will and the capability in Europe to project force beyond their borders. And their collective experiences, those of their allies in the EU and in NATO, have not exactly been encouraging. Just like the Americans, the EU countries have been humiliated in Afghanistan and Iraq, and also, more recently, in Libya. We Europeans basically also find it pretty difficult to cope with asymmetric warfare. So, why do I accuse Europe of being complacent? The reason is actually pretty straightforward. In the First World War, around 16 million people were killed. In the Second World War, depends how you count the numbers, between 55 million and 80 million, i.e. 10 million or more a year. But after that, the death rate took on a downward trend. Now, these are figures from Oslo's Peace Research Institute, and they are, I guess, the most reliable you can find, statistics. But the Peace Research Institute reckons that in the Cold War decades, from 1950 to the end of the 80s, period, actually, if you remember, actually probably you're too young to remember, it included the Korean War, the Vietnam War, two Arab-Israeli wars, a couple of India-Pakistan wars, one war in Afghanistan. The death rate over that span of years fell to around 180,000 a year. And in the final decade of the 20th century, it's just 100,000 a year. And in the first decade of this 21st century, death toll, a mere, inverted commas, 55,000 a year. So in other words, the world became progressively less violent and more attuned to supposed Western ideals. And that's why we became complacent. Francis Fukuyama, you may well have studied his books, in 1992 announced the end of history. So I'll sort of backtrack from that. But the idea was it was the triumph, permanent triumph, of Western capitalism and liberal democracy. George H.W. Bush was rather smarter, President Bush, in my opinion, than the second one, talked grandly of a new world order. By the end of the 20th century, all of the anarchist and insurgent groups and quotes terrorist groups, I don't like to use the word terrorist because one man's terrorist is another man's freedom fighter, but all the groups in Europe that were trying some way to threaten or overthrow the state, Italy's Brigate Rosse, Germany's Bademeinhof Gang or Red Army faction, Northern Ireland, the IRA, Spain's ETA, etc. They're more or less either they disappeared or they were almost irrelevant. So, no wonder we relaxed. True, there was a pretty bloody breakup of Yugoslavia, but the Balkan Wars of the 1990s are fading from the memory now. I mean, Serbia is trying to join the European Union, Croatia is in the European Union, and Bosnia-Herzegovina would like to join as well. Albania, which wasn't part of the Balkan Wars, has the same ambition. And there was a war, of course, in Russia, between Russia and Georgia in 2008, but it lasted for an amazing 5 days, so yeah, no big deal really. And in 2012, I think the European Union could pat itself on the back, by being awarded the Nobel Peace Prize, because, as the Nobel Committee said, it had for over six decades contributed to the advancement of peace and reconciliation, democracy and human rights in Europe. Well, fair enough. I mean, war between France and Germany is now inconceivable. Not bad for countries that had actually had three very nasty wars, including two world wars, within a century. So why do I say uncertain future as part of the title of that chapter four on Europe? Well, there are two reasons. One is the deterioration in the relationship between the West and the Russia of Vladimir Putin. Now, the obvious symbol of this is Russia's annexation of Crimea and its involvement in Ukraine, and then the West's punitive sanctions in retaliation. Now, from the West's point of view, Putin is indulging in provocative adventurism. But from Russia's point of view, the West, that's us, has actually been provocatively challenging Moscow's authority in its own backyard ever since the end of the Cold War. I mean, for example, the Warsaw Pact countries such as Poland joined NATO and the EU. And the West even dangled the prospect of NATO membership to countries such as Ukraine and Georgia. When Turkey downed a Russian jet just a few weeks ago, it made plenty of people wonder whether NATO's Article 5, you know, an attack on one is an attack on everybody, what it actually might mean, not just if Russia were to retaliate against Turkey, but also what would happen if Russia were to behave towards the Baltic states, Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia, which have large ethnically Russian minorities, in the same way as it has behaved with Ukraine. Well, that's one reason for Europe's uncertain future. But I think the more pressing reason is actually the situation in the Middle East and the propensity of some Europeans of Muslim faith, or Muslim background, not just to sympathize with ISIS, but to join ISIS, which actually, if you think about it, is testimony to our collective failure in Europe to properly integrate Muslim citizens. That failure applies, you know, not just to the multicultural approach that we in Britain have taken, but also to the determinedly monocultural approach that France likes to take. Now, what's conspired in this failure, I think, is actually the spread of Saudi Arabia's Wahhabi brand of Islam via mosques and madrasas funded by the kingdom's petrodollars. Now, I don't want to conflate exactly the doctrine and the behavior of the Islamic State, the so-called caliphate, with the doctrine and behavior of the kingdom. After all, the Saudis, they don't actually attack fear of the state. They don't declare that Shias are all heretics and must be killed, whereas the Islamic State does. But there's no denying that there really are some genuine similarities, and the Saud family is, of course, aware of this. It knows that it actually is in ISIS's sights as being corrupt and hypocritical. Well, and of course, you know that side part of this, that of the 19 hijackers who mounted the 9/11 attacks, 15 were Saudi nationals. Now, where did all this come from? And the point that I try to make in the book is that conflicts don't just appear like that, they have roots. And if you go back to the 1980s, there was a successful campaign to drive Soviet troops out of Afghanistan. Well, you find that during that campaign, Osama bin Laden was among the Mujahideen. And the Mujahideen was supported and financed by Saudi Arabia and the United States. So, as with our intervention in Libya, it's an injunction with hindsight to be careful what we wish for. Bin Laden's original quarrel with the Saudi government and with America was the Saudi invitation for American troops to be based in Saudi Arabia, in the kingdom, guardian of Islam's holiest places, ahead of the first Gulf War, when they were expelling Saddam Hussein's troops from Kuwait. Now, the question is, where do we go from here? The Syrian conflict part of a much larger problem in the Middle East. ISIS, Islamic State, Daesh, dollars a submit for a sham. It has in effect erased the frontiers which were drawn by Britain's Sir Mark Sykes and France's François-Georges Picot back in 1916. That's the days when we were a superpower and France was, wasn't a superpower, let's get there. Now, if those Sykes-Picot lines are actually gone forever, what does it mean for Syria? But what also does it mean for Jordan, which is another colonial creation? What does it mean for Iraq, which is already close to being dismembered between Shia, Sunni, and Kurdish regions? Well, Russia's involvement in Syria rings a lot of alarm bells. But one way of looking at its support for Bashar al-Assad is that it's an attempt to put the genie back into the bottle, to somehow return Syria to a secular dictatorship, when the alternative otherwise would be an apocalyptic theocracy. Well, can it happen? Frankly, I've got my doubts, but even optimists will acknowledge that the real difficulty in this great game of the Middle East are that all the pieces are in motion. Syria, disaster. Iraq, threatening to fragment. The Arab Spring, but afterwards, three failed states, Syria, Libya, Yemen, joining Somalia in that category. And you've got Egypt, as I said before, back under a dictatorship. The Taliban, back with a vengeance in Afghanistan and Pakistan. You know, if you saw the last series of, actually, an ultimate series of Homeland, it's a bit like that. Now, as long as this turmoil continues in the Middle East and North Africa, Europe is going to be threatened. And it's going to be threatened, especially because so many jihadists will be, European-born jihadists, will be coming back after doing their stint in the Islamic State. And at the same time, there'll be this huge wave of migrants. So there will be a real problem in the European Union of a shift politically to the right and the far right. And you'll notice that in the first round of the presidential election in Austria now, you had a far right guy heading the polls. So what can we do? Well, ideally, governments of the Middle East would actually get together to defeat the Islamic State. But actually, I find it pretty hard to imagine that there'll be a quick solution to Syria's civil war. The talks in Geneva at the moment are basically broken down. And I certainly can't imagine the Islamic State being defeated in the short term. I mean, it's in Yemen, it's in Libya, it's got affiliates now in Nigeria, and so on. And one reason that Islamic State won't be defeated in the short term is the reluctance of outside powers, with the possible exception of Turkey and Saudi Arabia, to put boots on the ground. Another reason is that the idea of a caliphate is actually very attractive to people who feel their governments are not providing them with jobs, and it harkens back to the days when there actually was an Arab and Muslim area that was the most advanced civilization in the world. So, ideally, Saudi Arabia, guardian of the holy spaces, and an Arab leader of the Sunni world, will be reconciled with Iran, the Persian leader of the Shia world. The trouble is, for that ideal to happen, there would have to be a change of heart, especially in Saudi Arabia. The Saudis have a paranoid fear of Iran. In part, that's because the Saudis are Arab, and there's a traditional antipathy to the Arabs and the Persians. But more immediately, it's the feeling that the Saudis have that Iran is intent on mastery of the whole region. The Saudis note that Iran has links to its fellow Shia Muslims in Lebanon by Hezbollah, in Syria by supporting Assad, who is a member of the Alawites, which is a quasi-Shia sect. And they note also Iran's involvement, which is, I think, true, although not very advanced, with the Zaydi Shiite Houthi insurgents in Yemen, and also backing the Shia majority in Bahrain. So, against all of that, the Saudis don't think are going to take a great step forward in trying to make a deal with Iran. At the same time, complicating the future, especially, I think, for the next president in the Oval Office, the Saudis have become extremely disappointed with America and obviously with Barack Obama. First, because Obama didn't punish the Assad regime when it crossed the red lines that he'd drawn against the use of chemical weapons. And then, perhaps more importantly, because the president continued his efforts to reach the nuclear deal with Iran, a deal which actually couldn't have happened without the support of Britain, France, and China, fellow members of the permanent five of the Security Council, and also Germany. So, you know, Europe got together with America and made a deal which I think is actually in the interest of everybody, but the Saudis and the Israelis would disagree. So, how does America now view Saudi Arabia? Well, fracking has eliminated America's reliance on Saudi oil. It's becoming harder and harder now, I think, for America to ignore the Saudi abuse of human rights. And it's been coming harder and harder. You see, in the press all the time, you know, journalists like Nick Kristof from the New York Times, harder and harder for America to ignore the fact that an awful lot of the Islamic State's doctrine comes from the Saudi Wahhabi school of Islam. And an awful lot of its money comes from Saudi citizens, not from the Saudi government, but Saudi individuals. Now, do we in Europe view Saudi Arabia in the same way? Well, same ambivalence. Well, I suppose we do in theory. Our ministers regularly, so they claim, raise issues of human rights when they talk to their Saudi counterparts in private. But the truth is that our arms manufacturers would hate us to lose their best market. You may remember that in 2006, the sainted Tony Blair forced the Syria's Foreign Office to drop its investigation into BAE Systems' dealings with Saudi Arabia. BAE Systems is Britain's biggest arms manufacturer. We shouldn't be surprised, actually, that Blair intervened, because the Yamala arms deal with Saudi Arabia, which I think is the biggest arms deal in history, it means many, many thousands of British jobs. So, shove comes to, push comes to shove. Yes, push comes to shove. I'm afraid that our ideals tend to take second place. Now, George Washington, America's first president, as Russell remembers from school days, his farewell speech famously warned his fellow Americans to beware foreign entanglements. It's not quite an accurate quote, but it's near enough. Well, frankly, in a globalized economy, that's impossible. There's always going to be a temptation in American politics towards isolationism. And that's a temptation that we in Europe need America to resist. Because we've learned through two world wars that in the end, Europe needs America, and we need to convince America, remember Obama's pivot to Asia, that America does actually still need Europe. So let me end with, I'm going to make five suggestions for the person that Russell's going to vote for, and then five suggestions for Europe's leaders. Okay, for America's president, I'd recommend, number one, that you listen first, not to all the Washington, D.C. think tanks, but to America's diplomats. The disastrous aftermath of the Iraq War was essentially because George W. Bush was taken in by the dogma of the neoconservatives, by the think tanks, particularly Bill Kristol, and their idea that democracy would automatically blossom in Iraq once Saddam had gone, that democracy would spread across the Arab world, and because Israel is a democracy and democracies don't fight each other, suddenly peace would break out between Israel and the Arab world. Second recommendation, listen to your allies. Now, France under Jacques Chirac was right to oppose the Iraq War. Britain under Tony Blair, my humble opinion, less humble, was wrong. But at least Britain did argue against the wholesale demobilization of the Iraqi army and the Ba'ath-dominated civil service. Number three, be sure to do what you say and say what you mean. Now, I admire Obama's rational approach to politics and his refusal to be gung-ho in foreign policy. It's a bit like when Harry Truman sensibly refused to let General MacArthur invade communist China during the Korean War. And you would certainly get a glib, you know, access of evil speech in a phrase in an Obama speech. But Obama's change of mind in 2013 over the red lines on Syria, I think it really has undermined American credibility in the world. And so imagine if you were in the Baltic States, how nervous you would be when confronted by an aggressive Putin. Will NATO, which after all takes its lead from America, will the NATO guarantee under Article 5 still hold, or when push comes to shove, would America back down? Number four, employ what Joseph Nye, scholar at Kennedy School at Harvard, called soft power. America's values attract far more than they repel. And you can see that if you look at any American consulate or embassy and you see the lines of people trying to get a visa. Number five, finally, for the American president, recognize that the world is a pretty complicated place and that America's powers are not unlimited. Of course, America and its allies could easily militarily destroy the Islamic State. But at what cost? Donald Rumsfeld once mused, are we creating more terrorists than we are killing? That's a good question to ask. Islamist extremism is not going to be defeated by force, nor by Western criticism. It's going to need a change of narrative within the Muslim world. And that's the change that we need to stimulate by promoting our values, our soft power. Now, what about my handful of recommendations for Europe's leaders? Well, number one, remember that the US really is an ally, however much times it infuriates us or even appalls us. The lesson of the Suez affair in 1956 is that America can't be ignored. Now, you remember Eisenhower forced Britain, France, and Israel to withdraw from the occupation of the Suez Canal, which Nasser had nationalized. Well, the chastened United Kingdom decided that after that, the only way to deal with America was to follow its lead always. France, under de Gaulle, by contrast, chose to think that the only way to cope with American power was actually to have a Europe, an integrated Europe, as a counterweight to the USA, and hence, the EU eventually. No matter which approach you take, the fact is NATO depends on American leadership, and both politically and militarily. Okay, number two, second recommendation for Europe leaders. Give sound advice and help to America, even if it risks angering its politicians. I mean, I really think Chirac did a brave thing and the right thing. But the reaction in the States at the time was, oh, these French are all cheese-eating surrender monkeys. And decent French wine was being poured down the drains in New York and Washington, D.C. Ridiculous. Number three, if necessary, be prepared to refuse America's requests, which Harold Wilson, to his credit, did in keeping Britain out of the Vietnam War. And I've already mentioned that Chirac kept France out of the Iraq War. Number four, just as with the States, use soft power. It doesn't really matter whether it's BBC World Service or the Rolling Stones or Daft Punk. And number five, last piece of advice, do more, much, much more, to integrate Muslim minorities. Now, that's much more easily said than done, but it is actually vital. And at the same time, resist the appeal of populism. Well, are those worthy recommendations going to bring us peace and tranquility? Will we eventually be more complacent again? Well, actually, I doubt it. George Santayana once said, only the dead have seen the end of war. And that's the end of my talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, John. We're a small enough crowd that I think you can probably field questions yourself. But
indeed.
Thank you very much. I think we will open up the floor now, so I'm just going to invite anyone who has any questions to throw them out. And we'll go from there. Stay here all night.
Yeah.
What do you make of Russia's newt military activities in the Arctic?
In the Arctic? I think it's part of, well, I think the Arctic has huge potential, as it actually does the Antarctic. It's worth bearing in mind, by the way, that Americans have signed ratified law of the sea. But I think if you're Putin, first of all, you want to somehow reestablish the Soviet Empire. I don't mean the Soviet Union, but the sphere of influence. And that has two benefits for him. Number one, I think it satisfies his own ego. And number two, not necessarily in disorder, it also distracts his own populace from the economic and social problems that Russia has. But, I mean, if you are Russia, the Arctic is your backyard, as well as it's Canada's or America's or Scandinavia's. So I think, you know, everything is to pay for there. I think one of the interesting things, though, is that the assumption is that the Arctic would be very, very valuable because of its petroleum reserves. Well, actually, petroleum at the moment seems to be becoming less and less valuable, not just for the immediate short term, but quite possibly for the long term, because renewables are getting more market share. Chinese demand is slowing because the Chinese economy is slowing. At the same time, China will become much more energy efficient. So the long-term future of oil and gas, I mean, it's certainly got a long-term future, but it's not going to be, I think, of the same stratospheric upward gradient that one could assume for the oil price before. And if you're going to get oil from the Arctic, you actually need, it needs a very high price, and it's very, very difficult to get oil from them.
Two quick questions. So the first one is, you mentioned briefly that you thought, quite hard right, that you think Britain would vote to leave the EU. Is that what you said?
Sorry,
you mentioned that you thought Britain would vote to leave the EU.
No, I hope it won't.
No, you hope, well, I thought you mentioned that you thought it would.
If I had to bet, I would bet that it will stay.
Yeah, okay, all right. You're wrong on that, so.
No, what I was saying was that I think there is a populist movement in most European, Western European countries now, provoked by the wave of immigration, which for Britain is a wave of migrants from Central and Eastern Europe, and for the rest of the European Union is actually also migrants from the Middle East and North Africa. So two different kinds of migrations, but nonetheless the impact is the same, and the result, you know, getting this populist right-wing consequence is the same. So I think that is what powers UKIP. But I think people are, in the end, I think will be level-headed. I mean, personally, I think, you know, I can see an intellectual argument for Brexit, but it's, for me, I feel European rather than Englander. And I think, you know, you leave the European Union with all its faults, and what you get, you're taking a risk. And I think in the end, people will be risk averse. Anyway, that's my hope, but who knows. I think a lot has changed in its polls because of Obama's intervention at the weekend.
To follow up on that, you gave a very wide ranging talk, and you talked about a lot of different interrelated concepts and things that are going on. But what I was thinking, given that your background journalism and reporting, and one of the things that good journalism and reporting does is identify stories that are key that aren't possibly being covered that then tend to change people's minds. So I was wondering if you were to prioritise one of the key things that maybe isn't getting enough coverage or should be covered in more detail that relates to what you're talking about, what would that be? What are we overlooking?
very good question, because the problem is that all newspapers and TV and radio companies have to sort of prioritize stories. And I think you said, all politics is local. And in a sense, all press coverage is local. You have some earthquake somewhere and maybe 3,000 are dead, but it's one Britain killed, so that's what gets covered. So there's always that bias. That means, of course, there are a lot of stories which do not get the attention that they deserve. For example, what's happening in Burundi now is actually very important, and because it could spark off again the Rwanda. It's got Hutus and Tutsis again. So, and that whole Rwandan conflict spilled over, and it still has its effect in Uganda, Central African Republic, part of Democratic Republic of Congo. That's a part of Africa that Britain and most European countries basically ignore, because their own interests don't seem to be immediately at stake, at risk. I don't know if you watch Al Jazeera English. It has really superb coverage of the world, which you don't get from BBC. I think BBC is a superb broadcaster, and you certainly don't get that coverage in the States. So I would say, maybe we'll be. Yeah.
Oh, well, first of all, thank you for coming to give us such an interesting talk. It's really interesting to say. I actually wonder if you could expand a bit more on one of the points that you said about your advice for the US president. I was really struck by the first one you mentioned about how the future president should ignore think tanks and special interests until you get to the Middle East. I'd love to know how you think that might work in something like the Israel lobby, because I would love to know how a president would be able to overcome the interests of something like that aspect of the think tanks and also to move beyond the interests of somewhere like that.
Yeah, it's very difficult. It's a very deceptive question. Washington, Russell will know well, is full of very good think tanks. But the problem is, I think, that think tanks, because they're private sector, they have to raise money. So they have to have a point of view. And then they get sort of stuck with that point of view. So AI, for example, is free market right-wing, or Cato the same. Brookings is more liberal-minded, in my opinion, independent. CSIS, there are dozens of think tanks. But they employ people who have to basically stick with a point of view. And they promote their point of view and raise money by getting a high profile. You get the high profile by always talking to politicians and by putting op-ed pieces in newspapers and so on. With that sort of froth going on, it's pretty difficult for politicians to ignore. And it is a fact that some things in America are almost like a red line. You touch it at your peril. You couldn't possibly, as a politician in America, say, well, I'm an atheist. Because if you look at the Almanac of American Politics, which is a superb publication, and it has all the politicians at the federal level and at the state level. And each one has religious affiliation. I think there's maybe one Muslim in the House of Representatives. But everybody is Episcopalian or Catholic or whatever. Well, you don't have that in Britain, dogs or vultures. No British politician would dream of putting his religious affiliation. Remember Alistair Campbell saying to journalists who asked about Blair, it was Tony Blair's avowedly Christian, saying, we don't do religion, or we don't say we don't do God, something like that. It's a different cultural perspective. Now your question is, how do you ignore that thing and come to a policy decision over something like Israel? I think the answer is maybe you can't. It has to be done very slowly, very gently. The only two presidents who have really taken on Israel, in a sense. Eisenhower was one, forcing Israel to move out of the Suez Canal. But that was after Sinai. But that was, you know, 56, and Eisenhower still had the power of the Second World War behind him, and Israel was then a very new country, you know, 1948 on, still new. To do it, the second president to do it was George H.W. Bush, who attached loan conditions, which had Israel unarmed, but perhaps had some impact. But the fact of the matter is that Israel has a power within the American political system for which there's no parallel in Europe. An American president just has to live with that. And I think every American president tries to end the legacy, and the hope of the legacy is to somehow get an Arab-Israeli final peace deal. I mean, Clinton came very close. George W. Bush had the meeting in the conference in Annapolis, which came very close. There's a rumor, which the Israeli press are full of now, that, and which I'm a little worried about, that Obama is now determined to do something in his final lame duck months. So who knows? I mean, it would be a real triumph if it could be achieved. And I mean, the Arabs like to think that the Israel-Palestine dispute is the mother of all problems. Well, in a sense, they're right. But actually, mother has been put into sort of a home somewhere, being looked after by someone else. And I don't think the Arab-Israeli dispute has the same political force that it used to have. During the Cold War, you could envisage, you know, theoretically, a Third World War breaking out because you have the proxy support of the Arabs, for the Arabs from the Soviet Union, and the support for Israel from the United States. Well, the Soviet Union is gone. And the Arab world, in a way, has learned to live with Israel. Israel has learned to live with the amount of violence. I mean, you have two intifadas now, possibly a third intifada, but a much more muted kind. You know, things are just there. There's no real development. I think it's going to have to wait until after the Islamic State is somehow solved. The problem in the meantime is that the idea of a two-state solution will, I think, have disappeared. I mean, I find it hard to be optimistic about the future of the Arab-Israeli issue. Yeah,
I've got a question. You mentioned a little while ago Obama's comments over the weekend. I was just wondering what your views were on those. Some effect, no effect, counter-effective?
According to the latest polling, if I read the headlines correctly, quite a big effect on the don't knowers. I mean, a lot of the Brexiteers, it's just that they feel passionately they are going to vote out regardless. I think quite a lot of the Remain will be equally passionate, but not to the same degree. I think the Remain camp is basically going to be much more sober, recognizing that the flaws, but it's better to be inside the camp, pissing out rather than outside the camp, as the American Marines would put it. It has had an impact, and I think it's made Boris, I think it's discomforted a bit.
I saw Liam Fox trying to talk his way around the other day. Not very successful.
Not very successful.
Yeah. I mean, Liam Fox very persuaded himself. Like he was trying to do it.
I think the follow-up, because Obama repeated this in Germany as well. So I think he's become a player in this particular game, and I think a rather important one, because one basis of the Brexit campaign was that we leave the European Union and we can make a deal straight away with our friends, the Americans. well, no, we're going to get the back of the queue. I mean, you could, people like Liam Fox or Michael Gove and so on, they're very smart. They can talk their way around it. But I think, nonetheless, they must have felt the impact.
Can I ask a quick unrelated follow-up? Thinking about Brexit, bringing together some of the strands of your talk, and the EU, insofar as the EU is some kind of foreign policy actor, do you think it would change its character if Britain is now out of it? If the Brexiters win, what's going to happen to the European Union as a foreign policy actor?
That's an extremely good question. Yeah, it really is. I mean, if you look at, EU foreign policy is a nice ideal. I think Solana was a very effective foreign policy high representative. Cathy Ashton, I don't really know what we are. I think Ms. Mogherini is doing a pretty good job. And you know, the European Union does have economic power to buttress its foreign policy aims. But and the players who really count in foreign policy in the European Union are Britain, France, and Germany. And you've got the three-legged stool. Now, if you take away one of those legs, then you've got France and Germany. Now, France and Germany are the motor, the essential engine of the European Union. Yeah, but the problem is that they can no longer pretend in Paris that it's an equal relationship. I mean, Germany is so much more successful economically. It's a bigger country. It's listened to more by America than France is. So if you don't have Britain in the European Union, then when it comes to foreign policy of the EU, the German voice becomes much louder than the French voice could ever be. And you saw that actually, it's not essentially a foreign policy, but you saw it in the dealing with Greece. I mean, Britain was basically not party to this because we're not a member of the Eurozone. So all the action was coming essentially from the other EU members in the Eurozone. And it's actually Schäuble who was calling the shots, and not the French, who wanted EU in the Troika to be much more embodied. And they didn't get their way. So I think it would not be good for, it wouldn't be such a balanced foreign policy.